So I'm going to jump out to a demonstration of Hyper-V replica. And Craig tells me that he's turned off the Wi-Fi now, so we shouldn't be going across the Wi-Fi. Okay, so I'm on demo machine one. So to do Hyper-V replication, what we do is we go into Hyper-V settings. There's a replication configuration tab, which I'm going to show you now. Okay, there is a replication configuration option. Hey. So as you can see here, we have a tick box that says enable this computer as a replica server. We have authentication and ports. In this environment where I'm replicating between my local machines here, I'm going to use Kerberos authentication over port 80. Okay? Don't recommend anyone else does it in production. Okay? This is purely a demonstration environment. In your lab, you're going to use SSL-based certificates. As we come down, you can see down here, we have authorization and storage. I'm going to allow replication from any authenticated server. So I've got an AD, all my nodes are in the AD, therefore I trust the other server. Otherwise, you could go in and, if you're using SSL certificates, you would specify the servers you want to allow to replicate to and from that server. And if I scroll down, you can see that that box is down there. So I've got all that configured, so let's hit OK. So I'm going to replicate this tenant to VM1. So we're going to go to enable replication. Next, the replica server. So I specify the server I want to replicate this VM to. So let's go to demo 2. We click next. The replica server comes up. The replication server port comes up that I'm going to replicate to. We're using Kerberos authentication. And I've got the tick box ticked for compress the data that is transmitted over the network. Okay? Remember, if you do compression, there will be a bit of a CPU overhead utilized on the host. If you turn compression off, it won't use as much CPU and RAM. So if your server's got heaps of available RAM and CPU, it doesn't really matter. But if you're getting critically low, you may want to drop that off. I can specify the virtual disks that I want to replicate. In this VM, it's only got one disk. But if I had two disks or three disks and I had a page disk, for example, I may not want to replicate the paged VHDX file. Okay? May just want to replicate just the contents that we need in a DR scenario. Choose the frequency that you want to replicate. I'm just going to leave this at 5 minutes. If it was really critical, I could set it at 30 seconds or 15 minutes. It's up to you what you want to set that to. We also have an option here where we can maintain additional recovery points. Okay? So instead of just having one replica, okay, I could have multiple instances. Okay? So I could say create additional hourly recovery points for a period of 24 hours. So that means over a 24-hour period, I have 24 copies of the server that I could roll back to. So all of a sudden, I've actually got a backup solution as well. How many of you could instantly fail over to a replica of a server today that is 5 seconds or 30 seconds behind your production server? Instantly. Like we're talking within like under 5 seconds. That's what we can deliver with Hyper-V replica. You can fail over to either a server in the same data center or to a DR site, and that server is live and functional within seconds. So when we go through that process, think about how many replicas do I want to keep for that customer? How critical is it? What SLA do I need to meet for that customer? We also have another nice little feature. So for those that have got large VMs and you're trying to replicate to another data center that may only be on a 10 meg pipe or a 100 meg pipe, and you want to transfer a 200 gig VM, okay, you can actually send the initial copy to an external media source. So you could plug in a USB drive if you wanted to, do the initial sync to that drive, then get one of your engineers to drive or send it via courier to your other data center. Once it's in that data center, plug it in. You configure the replication to occur off the disk onto that server, and then it'll just do a delta sync of whatever's changed in the time it took you to send the disk to that other location. Another good thought of the process for this, and one that I tell my customers to think about, is you can use Hyper-V replica to onboard customers from their premise into your data center. You can have them use Hyper-V replica from their server to your server. You sync. Once the servers are fully synchronized, you initiate a failover, and then the server is in production in your data center. There is very little outage to the customer, if any. The most biggest outage you're probably going to have is DNS if there's an external DNS record that needs to be changed. So we have multiple different options there for the use of Hyper-V replica. And that's what I mean when we go through the process of the technologies we talk about today and tomorrow. How can we use these technologies for other solutions? So one of the other things we're going to do is go next. So sorry, we're going to start the replication immediately. I'm not going to schedule it, but you could schedule it if you want to. We get a confirmation box that shows the replica server, the server port, compression, yes or no, the authentication type, frequency times, and using the network and starting immediately. So we're going to confirm all of that and hit finish. And you can now see that we're sending the initial replication data. So if I zoom in, you'll be able to see that. I now have tenant 2, VM1, is sending the initial replica. If I go to demo 2 in my Hyper-V manager, I can see that VM now exists on that Hyper-V server, and it's now receiving the changes. Okay, so it's flowing along. That's going to take a little while. We're at 33%. It's still clicking up. But down the bottom here, you'll also notice there is a replication tab, okay? And down here on that replication tab, we can see the replication mode is a replica. We're pending initial replication. The replication health is showing a warning because we're still synchronizing. It shows the primary server, I'm the replica server, and last synchronized that is not applicable because we haven't finished the first sync. So we're at 65%, it's almost there. So once that's initially synced, which we're almost there now, once the synchronization's occurred, you can then instantly start failover if you had to. Okay? This initial synchronization, once it's occurred, we can also do a test failover. Okay? A test failover is where we fail over to the secondary copy of the server, okay? But we don't put it on the production network. You can configure a test network so when you fail over in test mode, you can test the DR, but it's not going to affect the production servers. The server comes online, it has an IP address on your test network, okay? Your client can connect to that on a new IP address and things like that, and you can fully test DR failover without having to take the production server offline. So what happens during the replication process is that when we do a test failover, the replication is put on hold. Okay? When the replication is, when you finish testing, it goes back into full replication mode and the synchronization will pick up whatever's changed during that process. But if you look at the processes that we have in place, and that's completed now, but if I was to have three copies of my VM, the production one, a secondary site, and a DR site, what I would normally recommend is that you would stop the replication to the DR site, test the DR, and you still have a secondary copy sitting somewhere. Okay? So if you're going to do DR testing, it may be worth putting in another replica of the server and use that one instead of the secondary copy. So maybe start a tertiary copy and do your DR testing on that, if it's critical that you capture any changes during that testing phase. So that's finished. So we have replication. So on the VM, I can go to replication, I can failover, test failover, pause the replication, extend the replication period. I can view the replication health or remove replication. Okay? So if you really wanted to, if you've got a customer that you've onboarded by using Hyper-V Replica and they no longer want to replicate between the two sites, okay, you can disable the replication and you will have the server running on your environment and you're fully functional. There's no more replication back and forth. And on demo one, you can see if I go to replication, we have less options. Okay, on the server that's the primary replication server, all we can do is to do a planned failover, pause or view replication, or remove replication. On the node that is the replica of the primary, we have more options because that's where, if there's a DR scenario, that's where we're going to initialize the active go live process. So we can also come into settings on that server. And this is the replica of on the demo 2 server. So this isn't the production one, this is the replica. I can expand network adapter. And I'll show you right now. I'll zoom in so you can see it on the screen. I've gone to failover TCP/IP. So if I wanted this VM when I fail over to start with a different IP address, this is where I'd input that information. Okay? We can also have the test failover section where I can also go to the virtual switch and pick the virtual network I want to use when I do a test failover. Okay, so if I created that test network, this is where I'd configure that. So that pretty much wraps up the replica demo. But again, I'll just show you one last setting where you can see the recovery points, how often we're doing it, and everything else. So once you have created it, you can go into the settings and change it or see what settings have been configured.